Check it out now, y'all.
nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Welcome back to Unit 4 of our course on quantum transport. This is the second lecture. Now, as I mentioned in the introduction, a very important experimental result that actually one could say started the field of spintronics is the fact that if you had a device with two magnetic contacts that were parallel, the resistance is lower than if they're anti-parallel. And this is something that found widespread application in terms of reading information from magnetic disks. So the question is, how would you include this in our NEGF model? Now, the basic model, as you remember, for any channel with two contacts, we need the H that describes the channel. You need the self energies that describe the two contacts. And once you have that, here we are talking of coherent transport. We are not worrying about interactions within the channel. And so you can calculate this retarded Green's function from which you can get the transmission, which is like the conductance normalized to the quantum of conductance. Now, so how would we write down these matrices? Now, consider in this discussion, so as you know, in general, you choose this lattice and or what you might call the basis functions. And if your lattice has, say, 10 points, then your matrices are 10 by 10. For this discussion, let's assume the device only involves one basis function, one point. In that case, the matrices are just one by one. So it's just a number. And that number is, let's say, epsilon. That's like a single energy level. I've written it as if it's a matrix by putting in these square brackets. But it's really a one by one matrix, which is a number. Now, what about the sigmas? Well, let's say the rate at which it goes out is given by this gamma 1. And then, as you know, the rate at which it goes out is gamma 1, then the corresponding sigma would be minus I over 2 times gamma 1. So that when we define I sigma minus sigma dagger, and this dagger is conjugate transpose, but since these are 1 by 1, transpose doesn't matter, so it's just conjugate. And so when you do this, what you get is like the negative imaginary part times 2. Anyway, so for this gamma, the corresponding sigma looks like this. And you're not worrying about any real part of sigma. Similarly, for this gamma, you have that one. And given this H and sigma, you can write down the retarded Green's function. This is E, that's H. Next one is sigma 1, next one is sigma 2. So this is E minus H minus sigma 1 minus sigma 2, and then inverse. Now what's GA? That's this conjugate transpose of GR. And again, transpose doesn't matter, it's just a number. So you want conjugate, so plus I becomes minus I. That's it. Now you take all that and you can put it in here, and again, trace simply means this number, because trace is the sum of everything on the diagonal. So you just have to multiply out those four quantities. And when you do that, you'll get this. You see that gamma 1 is the gamma 1 here, that gamma 2 is that gamma 2. And GR times GA, that's like multiplying this with this. One is the conjugate of the other. So you get the magnitude squared of that quantity, which is E minus epsilon squared plus gamma 1 plus gamma 2 over 2 squared. So that's the transmission. And usually what we do is, we then multiply it by 2. Because we say, well, we all know that there are upspin levels and downspin levels, and we have just been talking about one of them. So 2 of them will give you twice as much transmission, twice as much conductance, or half as much resistance. Now, for our present problem, though, we cannot multiply by 2. Why? Because the entire physics lies in these contacts making unequal contacts to the two types of spins. So you cannot just handle one spin and multiply the result by 2. What you have to do is explicitly take into account the 2 channels, the 2 spins, the up and down. So now if you try to write the H, instead of being just a number epsilon, you'll now have a 2x2 matrix. And we are assuming this is just an ordinary non-magnetic channel. And so it's epsilon, epsilon, both on the diagonal. So these are equal. That's a diagonal matrix. Both diagonal elements are the same. So that's like epsilon times the identity matrix. But when you write the gammas, that's when I guess you have to note that up and down could have different gammas. Because as I mentioned earlier, the basic physics, I guess I mentioned this in the introductory lecture, that the basic physics of these magnets is that one type of spin can go out easily compared to the other type of spin. And so we write gamma 1 up, gamma 1 down. Here you put a gamma 2 up, gamma 2 down. So each is now a 2x2 matrix. And once again, we could do the same algebra, multiply them all out and take the trace. Except that here, we don't really need matrices. And that's because all matrices are diagonal. So basically, all we are doing is treating 2 separate channels, an up channel and a down channel, and adding them up. And so if you actually put in these matrices, multiply it out, take the trace, what you'll get will look just like our old result, except that there'll be 2 terms. You see, one from the 1-1 element and one from the 2-2 element. And when you take the trace, you'll be adding them. And for the 1-1 element, you'll have something that looks just like this, except for that subscript of U everywhere. And for the 2-2 element, you'll have again something looking like this, except for the subscript of D everywhere. So finally, the answer will look something like this. Now, the next thing I want to do is make a little approximation, which isn't really necessary. I just want to simplify the algebra a little bit here. In general, you don't need to make that assumption. And that is, what we'll assume is that the Fermi level or the electrochemical potential is far below these energy levels. That is, remember, we assume that our channel has an upspin level and a downspin level, both with energy epsilon. And when you calculate this transmission, what you want is the transmission at an energy equal to the Fermi energy. That's at low temperatures. So that's this equilibrium electrochemical potential. And what we are assuming is that we can drop these 2 terms in the denominator. So when can we assume that? Well, if this happens to be much less than that. So what does this represent? Well, this represents the broadening of the level. You know, anytime you connect it to a contact, as we have discussed, it leads to a broadening. And that's this broadening. And we are assuming that that is much less than the distance from the epsilon to the mu. So this is a case of what you might call a tunneling junction. So just one related fact I should point out is that these experiments with parallel and anti-parallel contacts, I guess, were originally done on materials like copper, which are good conductors. You see, where the Fermi energy is actually in the middle of your energy levels. But nowadays, a lot of the devices employ what are called magnetic tunnel junctions, where this channel is actually an insulator and the electron tunnels through it. So the approximation we are making here would apply to the tunnel junctions. But if you wanted to treat good conductor like copper, then you should assume that this is right in the middle. And then you should, to find the conductance, actually have to integrate over energy. And you could do that. It just takes a little more algebra. And I won't go into it because our purpose here is more to explain how to write down these matrices. Okay. So anyway, so if you make this assumption then you see the denominators are both equal. So I could put mu 0 minus epsilon square. And in the numerator, I'll get gamma 1 u, gamma 2 u, plus gamma 1 d, gamma 2 d. Okay. So next, then, we note that if the contacts are parallel, then when you look at the upspin channel, it can, say, get out into the contacts at a rate, say, alpha. But if you look at a downspin channel, the rate at which they can get out is much lower. Why? Because these are magnets that are pointing up. And so the density of states in these magnets, there is not enough density of states for downspins. And so you have this lower rate of getting out, which we'll call beta. So beta is, say, less than alpha. Now, on the other hand, when you look at the anti-parallel channels, that's when you reverse that, and we'll come to that in a minute. Now, if you just put in these alphas and betas into here, you see what happens is, this is alpha, that's alpha, so alpha squared plus beta times beta, that's beta squared. So the parallel transmission is like alpha squared plus beta squared divided by this denominator. Now we go to the anti-parallel case. In the anti-parallel case, you see, the upspin channel goes out here very easily, that's alpha, but has a tough time going out there, so that's beta. This one has a tough time getting out on this side, but can get out on this side much more easily, so that's alpha. Now when you put those numbers in here, you'd get alpha times beta plus beta times alpha, so that's like 2 alpha beta. So what this tells you then is that the parallel transmission will be proportional to alpha squared plus beta squared, and the anti-parallel transmission is proportional to 2 alpha beta. And what we can show is that this is always bigger than that, so that the parallel transmission is bigger than the anti-parallel transmission, and so the resistance is lower. Now, in devices, people define something called the tunneling magnetoresistance. So this is for tunneling devices, they call it the tunneling magnetoresistance, TMR, and it's defined as the ratio of the anti-parallel to the parallel resistance minus 1. Or you could think of it as the change in resistance, RAP minus RP, divided by RP. So we can evaluate that by noting that resistance is inversely proportional to transmission. So RAP over RP is like TP over TAP. And if you put in the values we just calculated, you'd get that. And the numerator then is alpha square plus beta square minus 2 alpha beta, which is alpha minus beta square. If I multiply by 2, you have 4 alpha beta, which is like the difference between those. And the reason I'm writing it this way is, you can then divide through by alpha plus beta square, and you could write it in the form of 2p square over 1 minus p square, where p is this alpha minus beta over alpha plus beta. And this is a very standard result. That is, this is something people use widely, that what is p? Well, that p tells you how good your contact is in terms of discriminating between upspins and downspins. You see, that discrimination is reflected in the difference between alpha and beta. So this p is a measure of that. Ideally, what you'd like is beta to be zero. That is, a contact should only let one type of spin get through and not the other type at all. And people are looking continually for magnets, for new materials which would actually do that. At this time, usually, it's never that good, but over the years, the polarization, this P has improved significantly. And the way you relate the measured quantity, this TMR, to the P is this 2P square over 1 minus P square. And you can see, if P were 1, then actually, of course, you'd have an enormous TMR. That is, the RAP would be way bigger than the RP. And that's exactly what you want for applications. Anyway, so the main point, though, as I said here, was although I was using this device as an example, my purpose was really just to show how you write down the matrices. And the point I tried to make is that for magnetic contacts, the first important piece of physics is that upspins get out more easily than downspins. And if you turn the magnet, let's say you reverse it, then of course the beta and the alpha are reversed. And that seems like an intuitive argument. What is not clear from this argument, though, is how would you handle a magnet that's pointing not up or down, but somewhere in between? And that requires us to get into some of the subtle issues of magnets, which we'll take up in the next lecture. Thank you.